Welcome in to First Things First. I'm Sarah Kusak, filling in for Jenna Wolf. That's Chris Broussard. That's Doug Gottlieb.
What a teammate. What a teammate. Ty was on his
face. It was a no look, too. It was a no look.
I didn't know what you guys were doing.
No, listen.
I'm just glad you made it.
Well, listen, for people who don't do television normally, what usually happens is somebody waits till the segment is over and then says, oh, hey, by the way, your tie was off. Chris Broussard, great teammate, like, dude, straighten it up. This whole thing. I can't really.
I can't pick something.
We're stuck. Well, we're glad that you're here with us. Some serious news to start with at Ohio State. Urban Meyer has been placed on paid administrative leave as the university announced it was looking into Courtney Smith's assertion that many close to Meyer, including Meyer's wife, had knowledge of the 2015 allegation of domestic violence against her ex-husband, former assistant Zach Smith, who was fired in July. Courtney Smith told reporter Brett McMurphy, quote, I do believe he knew, and instead he chose to help the abuser and enable the abuser and believe whatever story Zach was telling everybody. Chris, what's your reaction to this news?
I mean, this is always tough because obviously you want to hear all the facts. And Ohio State's doing an investigation. Obviously, we just hope that they do a thorough, fair investigation and don't give any preferential treatment, you know, to Urban Meyer. But look at the facts and come to, you know, a conclusion from there. But if the allegations are true, that he knew of not just two incidents in 2009 but in 2015, those are bad enough, but it was a consistent, reportedly, a consistent pattern of domestic violence within that relationship. His wife from the text seemed to know about that. So if Urban Meyer knew about that, if it's true that his life coach, Hiram DeFries, I don't know how you say DeFries. His mentor, Earl Bruce, that they went to her in 2009 after Zach Smith abused her when she was pregnant and tried to convince her not to press charges. If all of that's true, then I'm sorry, there's only one conclusion. He has to be fired. It's as simple as that. Jim Tressel, you know, I know he, you know, covered up the tattoo scandal and all of that, but he was fired. That is so much less significant and serious than domestic violence that there's no choice but to fire Urban Meyer if this is the case.
Yeah, the cover up becomes worse than the crime. I mean, let's just start. I mean, obviously, I'm a husband, but also a human being. You have no time for anyone. Even previous to America kind of, you know, getting the gumption to eradicate it from sports, no time for men who abuse women. None. Okay? On the other hand, and this is very, very important in context of this story, is there were consistent, apparently, allegations, but not charges.
Right.
Okay? I don't even think most of that matters. I really don't. Because I think when we dig in, we're going to find it's a really toxic relationship between a man and a woman. I have no idea what to believe. There are some pictures, and the pictures are damning. But I don't even think that matters. What matters is Urban Meyer backed himself into a corner last week at Big Ten Media Day for no reason at all, saying he hadn't even heard of the 2015 allegations, hadn't heard of it, and I hadn't heard of it, and that just becomes impossible to believe.
Right.
On two levels. First, as you pointed out, that he was brought in to help counsel the couple in 2009. Counsel the couple. And he even said as much. He admitted as much at the dais at Big Ten Media Day, where he said, look, it wasn't what it was said to be,
Yeah. But
we still, it was a young couple, and we chose to counsel.
And that's good. People can make mistakes.
That's leadership. That's
exactly
what you're supposed to do, okay? So to tell me that you have a guy who's an intern on your staff in 2009, he's the grandson of your mentor, you decide when you come out of the broadcast booth to hire him as an assistant coach at Ohio State that you're not going to keep an eye on that you're not going to be alerted to it at all in 2015? Because what gets you fired is not that one of your assistant coaches is alleged to have abused his now ex-wife. That's not what gets you fired. What gets you fired is you don't report it. Or you don't tell your bosses.
That's a violation of the Title IX.
Right. And more than anything, like, look, if people are pointing out that on Ohio State's wall, when players walk in every day, it talks about respecting women. And that's incredibly important. But above where it says decisions, treat women with respect. Forget that. Look at the first word after decisions. honesty.
Yep.
If you lie to your bosses, and by lying is, we all know in relationships, not telling something you know is also lying. That's covering up the truth. Yep. You are going to get yourself fired. And so I think we've begun the process of, holy cow, Urban Meyer is going to fall on the sword. And look, I want to give him a pass for trying to save Carlos Dunlap, who had the DUI before the SEC championship, for trying to save Aaron Hernandez, a troubled kid from Bristol, Connecticut. Because I'm the son of a coach and a brother of a coach, I understand that head coaches think they can save people.
Yeah. Okay?
But at some point, you start to realize that you surround yourself with enough dogs that you're going to get fleas. And I think that's what this is a case
of. If this is true, this wasn't just about trying to save somebody. This was whether you're looking out for him because Earl Bruce, who was your mentor,
right,
he's his grandson, or whether because he's a superb wide receivers coach or whatever.
No one is that good a wide receivers coach.
This wasn't just, I'm trying to help you out. And here's the deal. You said it at the beginning. We don't want, you know, to tolerate men that put their hands on women.
Right.
But let's face it, all right, in sports culture, male sports culture, and somewhat male culture, period, that has not always been the case. There are icons that we still revere in sports who we know repeatedly put their hands on women. You know, so this is society is changing. And the only way we're fully going to get where we need to be as far as domestic violence is if society stigmatizes it so badly that it is the utmost shame to put your hands on a woman. If you're known as a man and put your hands on a woman, you are shamed to the nth degree. Society can put that type of stigma on it. And when they do, sure, it will still happen occasionally as men get impulsive in the heat of the moment and all that. But I bet you it would cut it down to a great degree. And the only way to start stigmatizing, it's already begun.
Yeah.
But to really go the full length that we need to go, somebody needs to be made an example of. And it needs to be shown that, look, we're not going to put sports, coaching excellence, playing excellence. This goes for players, too. And we're not going to put any of that above the treatment of women. And so Urban Meyer, if this is true, and he knew about this, he needs to be made an example of so it can be cut down in the future.
Well, look, I want to be fair because there has been, even in sports, false accusations. Okay? There have been false accusations. I agree with you in that there should be no taboo in reporting domestic violence, right? And that we need to get your hands off women. I don't even have time for a man who puts his hand on a woman. I understand that. But I don't even want to get in the weeds as to what actually happened. The issue is there are multiple reports that she called the cops. She clearly was communicating with his wife. He has said he shares everything with his wife.
Yeah.
His wife, in fact, is employed by the university's nursing program.
So right? She's definitely violating
Now, so we can say that she may fall on the sword. She may, to steal from Chris Carter, who normally occupies that seat, she may be the fall guy, right? but that's not acceptable. That part is not acceptable. When you're in charge, you have to report these things. What did he know? When did he know it? And what did he do about it? And if you mean to tell me that one of your assistant coaches had the cops called in Columbus, Ohio, when you're the head coach at Ohio State and you didn't know anything about it, forget the text messages. I don't buy it. I just don't. We used to have a saying at Oklahoma State, you break wind on campus, they smell it in the office. They know everything about what goes on. And so that's why they make so much money, is because, this does fall under their purview. Yeah. And so my bigger issue is, did you know something about it? And if you did you not tell the proper authorities? Did you not put it up the chain of command? And they said, hey, look, we investigated and it's fine. You can lie to the media. You can tell us whatever. But if you lie to your boss, you're going to get fired.
What does this mean for Ohio State? Is there any circumstances that you see Urban Meyer still being the head coach of the Ohio State football team?
Yes. I mean, that would be if all of this had been reported by his wife. The problem is, if these things had been reported, if he had handled it with the gone through the proper steps, why'd they fire Zach Smith?
If he had. But from what we know now, he didn't.
Right.
So, look,
But there are some privacy acts to which we don't know what was shared.
Yeah.
To be candid, we don't know everything as of yet.
And that's why we want to see the investigation.
But that's the only way. If they knew, if his wife knew, the assumption is he knew and he didn't report, I don't know how he stays.
You also have to look at this. I mean, and I know this was long ago, but Woody Hayes, you know, got fired under the scandal of hitting a player. Jim Tressel. Another scandal there. Both wildly successful coaches. And now you have Urban Meyer. So Ohio State's program, at many times it looks like they put winning ahead of ethics. And so that's something I think they need to take into consideration.
You bring up Jim Tressel, who is a wildly successful, incredibly popular, and was seen to have great ethics.
Yes,
you know, presented himself
very much like
presented himself with the vest, and the flag behind him and the lapel
religion,
pin.
All that.
But the reason he got fired was not because his players sold gold pants in order to get tattoos, or because Terrell Pryor was driving around a car who no one knew who paid for it. The reason he got fired was because he lied to the NCAA, and the assumption is he lied to Gene Smith, his boss.
Yeah.
You lie, you get fired. It really doesn't have to do with the actual crime. It's whether or not you cover up the crime.
In this situation, though, the crime needs to be taken into
consideration. I'm not disputing that, but the point is that.
And even if there's no crime, like if he knew, and you're right, the guy hasn't been charged with anything, you know, but if they knew that this was going on, you got to do something about it. You're a leader of men.
Correct.
And in every other way, when it comes to football, you're on top of every detail. You don't tolerate, you know, foolishness. But you're going to tolerate this? It's just like, I mean, it's a different thing, but the Sandusky and Paterno thing in Penn State.
No room for this. No room for this. But we have got more. First things first, right after this. Thanks for sticking with us. Paul is officially back. The Bears take on the Ravens in the Hall of Fame game tonight, and all eyes will be on rookie quarterback Lamar Jackson. The dual-threat Heisman winner will certainly get some reps for Baltimore. He's looking to, quote, show off his growth since he was drafted in the first round. Doug, will Lamar Jackson be a successful NFL quarterback?
Long-term, I don't believe he will be. I think there'll be moments when he plays, and probably you're talking about next year and the following year for the Baltimore Ravens. There are things that he can do athletically and things that he can do with his arm, which very few people have ever played football,
right,
if anybody can actually do. The issue is his consistency. Look, there's an issue with his size. There's the issue with his durability. There are no old running quarterbacks, right? And he can sit here and say, well, look, I want to evolve, and I hope he does. I really hope he refines his skill. But he played for an incredible offensive coach in Bobby Petrino, and he wasn't an accurate passer. There's just some spots of inaccuracy which are hard to get away from. I don't think long-term he's going to be a difference maker in the National Football League. I do think that, and we've seen this from whether it was RG3 or Vince Young, that at times some of these quarterbacks come in and they set the world on fire. But
right,
the way to stick in this league for a long term is throw from the pocket. That's where we can protect you. That's what makes Russell Wilson, that's what's allowed Russell Wilson to evolve, is throwing the football from the pocket or planting your feet when you're on the move and throwing the football. He's just too inaccurate at times. I don't believe long term he's a great quarterback.
Yeah. Look, I would love for Lamar Jackson to become a superstar in the NFL. He's so fun to watch. He's so electrifying. I mean, it would be tremendous for the league. There's very few things I'd rather see in the NFL than Lamar Jackson becoming a superstar. But I'm with you. I don't think he will be. Now, you brought up, you know, he's got a great arm. You know, he's got some things playing in that offense, you know, could help him as far as, you know, reads and things like that, playing in a pro-style offense in college. But one of my main concerns is I don't think he could stay upright as a running quarterback. I mean, Randall Cunningham was a great running quarterback, but he got injured a lot. When he was healthy, he was fantastic, but he got injured a lot, and that's because he was running quarterback. Donovan McNabb was 240 pounds. You know, Cam Newton has trouble staying fully healthy, and he is twice as big as Lamar Jackson. I, you know, look at how RG3 got hurt, you know, after that spectacular year. running the ball. Look at how Carson Wentz got hurt, running the ball. Russell Wilson is so intelligent about the way he runs and getting out of bounds, sliding, that he's able to do it. But I think if Lamar Jackson is going to be a running quarterback, I mean, no matter how well he tries to adjust and throw the ball, he's going to run. And at his size, I think he would get broken up and be injured too much to be a long-term great quarterback.
Look, I don't know him personally, but I have talked to NFL people, and they paint the picture of a guy who also is behind in terms of his football acumen. Yeah. He just is. That at the whiteboard and in trying to talk through kind of the schematics of offense in leading up to the NFL draft, they were really disappointed with how far behind he was in comparison to others. Now, look, you can learn a ton, and if you're a sponge, the issue I have is not just that what he doesn't know, but the fighting what he doesn't know and the fighting some of the things that people have told him, you know, the representation issues that he's had, the presentation issues that he's had, the thing that I don't even want to run the 40. Why wouldn't you want to run the 40 and run the fastest 40 we've ever seen? I actually think the Cam Newton parallel is a good one, because one of the big issues that Cam Newton has is that he's inaccurate, right? And Cam Newton is bigger, stronger, and has a better arm. He has a good arm. He snap throws the ball, and it gets out with good velocity.
And as they improve his technique, I think it could become a great arm.
Sure. But there becomes footwork issues as well, right? That's part of it is when you've always had the default to where you can throw it a mile, and if not, you can tuck it and run it, you have to completely rework through your footwork. And I think what people don't understand is they're like, wait, he's a great athlete. He's incredibly adept in terms of his speed and quickness and elusiveness. But that's different when you compare it to Tom Brady, who has incredible in-pocket footwork. That's something that takes years and years and years to perfect. So I think he's fighting the fact that his default is to run. I think he's fought some of what people have told him about his inaccuracy, and I think he's really behind in terms of his football IQ. I think they're going to use him smartly this year. You might not see it tonight. I think they'll use him as a slash. I think they'll use him in certain packages, and I think he'll be incredibly explosive and fun to watch. The problem with that is evolving into a true traditional starting quarterback, and very few have been able to do it. The ones that have had years or 2 years where they take the league by storm, but they're not consistent.
Right, right.
The ability to be consistent is be accurate, understand, understanding reading defenses and knowing your offense, and can you throw from the pocket? He's got those things to work on.
Look, I'm fine with him, you know, even the 40-yard dash. Okay, I would have loved to have seen him run the 40, but I'm fine with him digging in and saying, I am a quarterback for now, okay? But in a year, 2 years, 3 years, whatever, it may take moving to receiver or something else for him to stay in the league. And he has to be open to that. Because I don't think he can make it as long-term.
Yeah, I'm glad you were, because we talked about that so much leading up to the draft or leading up to the combine. Do you think he will ever consider switching positions? Or do you think that's even a smart thing to have him considering or have a team considering about him?
Well, look, they're already playing him at wide receiver. They're just saying we have two quarterbacks on the field at once, right? Well, we have two quarterbacks. Wait, Joe Flacco's under center. He's at wide. No, we have two quarterbacks on the field. So, look, I think the path to success for him that Baltimore is paving is just like Cordell Stewart, right? Play him as a slash early in his career and hope he evolves into being a starting quarterback. And if it doesn't work, yeah, then you do whatever it takes to. That's what I would have liked to him to say. I understand, hey, I'm a quarterback, I want to be judged as a quarterback, but I also would have liked the caveat of, but I'm willing to do whatever it takes to get on a football field because I love football and I just want to be a part. You know, like,
but
even
then
if
they may have said, all right, you're a receiver.
But looking at the speed,
looking at the athleticism, have been what they said.
Here's the whole thing, okay? The Chargers scout who mentioned to him about running the receiver routes kind of said it tongue-in-cheek in conversation when they were on the field at the Combine in Indy. And he's got a burr in his saddle about it. He's super defensive about it, and he made it into a big thing. The Chargers weren't evaluating him as a quarterback. No. None of these teams, I mean, as a wide receiver, they were evaluating him as a quarterback. But you want to see what else he can do. You want to see how much he understands the actual routes. That helps you as a quarterback if you have complete command and control of the routes and the timing of being a wide receiver. And the fact that he's so defensive about it actually, to me, makes him a guy I think less of than instead of thinking more of.
But here's the thing. He's played quarterback his entire life.
Yes.
He's been successful. For all we know, I don't think it was racial. He may think it's racial.
I think he does.
Yeah, he may think you're not giving him a shot. Look, it wasn't racial. I mean, Tim Tebow, nobody thought he could play quarterback. Eric Couch, you know, Scott Frost. We've seen it before with white players who didn't have those types of skills in college. So I don't think it was racial, but he may think that, and that may be one reason defensive.
There's no question about it. I'll just say, if there's a white quarterback who can run a 4-2 who's inaccurate, they're going to talk to him about playing wide receiver. That's the game. It doesn't, but I completely understand that you come into the NFL and there is the thought in mind where they're going to try and make a black quarterback to be a running quarterback. No, he just happens to be an African-American quarterback who's a crazy athlete, and he's got a great arm. It's, can you hone those skills? I'm betting that he can't consistently hone it, but I'm willing to be proven wrong.
I hope we are both proven wrong, because I'd love to see him.
Speaking of a crazy athlete that might be a little defensive coming up, you're not going to believe what Kevin Durant tweeted now. That's next.
KD.
Eyes will be on Tiger Woods when he tees off at 10:20 a.m. at the WGC Bridgestone Invitational. Woods is tied for the second best odds to win in Akron this weekend.
Well, this is his spot.
He says he's looking to play in 5 of the next 6 tournaments. Doug, is this doable for Tiger?
Yeah, I mean, I think he's challenging himself. One, he doesn't like, I don't think he's a grinder on the practice tees and practice greens nearly as much. He wants more tournament action. I mean, look, this is a place in Akron where he consistently wins. So you'll get a good sense. He's got a little taste of it, right? When he took the lead at the Open Championship, he got a little taste of it. He knows he's getting close, and that's why I think he's got that grinder mentality. If he wins this weekend, I think you put yourself as the favorite potentially to win the PGA. This is great news for golf, great news for his back surgeon, who's going to be selling that thing to every client who walks in.
That's what I was going to say, Doug. As excited as we and the golf world are about Tiger potentially being back and, you know, playing well and putting himself in position to win some tournaments, he's just as excited.
Yes.
He's not going to show
it.
But inside, he's excited. That's why he's like, okay, now I'm going to play. He knows the more he plays, he's probably going to get better and better. At least I'm sure that's what he thinks. And so I'm hyped about Tiger.
Week 1's Jags-Giants game features a great matchup of two of the best in the game when Odell Beckham Jr. faces off against Jalen Ramsey. Ramsey guaranteed that, quote, we're going to give the people a show. Chris, how excited are you for these two to face off?
Well, look, you got two of the best at their position. It's not going to be OBJ versus Josh Norman, thankfully, right? But I think as far as football, I mean, I think they're going to keep it clean for the most part. They're both tremendous. I'm not going to bet against OBJ. He's going to get his. Ramsey's going to have his moments. He's going to look good. But I do think OBJ is going to get his. Look, he's excited to be back. He wants to show everybody what he can do. We'll see what his contract situation is. But obviously, if it's not settled, that's going to be even more motivation. I love his attitude now. I love the fact that he's coming.
OBJ's?
Yeah.
Okay.
I love it the way it is now. And I just think this bodes well for him to have a tremendous game and season.
Well, let's see what his attitude is, because Jalen Ramsey, in addition to liking the fact that he walks it like he talks it, he can really play, but he also likes to talk it, and he is a chirper, and he will get in your face. And that's the challenge for Odell Beckham Jr. Has he grown? Has he matured? Can he just play football? If he just plays football, he stays healthy, the guy's a freak. The guy's a top 5 wide receiver. It's not just the catches. It's the route running. It's the explosiveness when he catches the football. Yeah. I want to see the rebuilt offensive line and how it handles that dynamic Jags defense. We want to see if the Jags, who decided to not make a change at quarterback, can dominate the Giants defense. But everybody wants to see Jalen Ramsey and OBJ?
Someone you might have to wait to see, Earl Thomas. Pete Carroll, who ripped his all-pro safety for not reporting to camp last week, was short with his answer recently, saying that the team has had no communication with Thomas. Doug, how will this all play out?
He'll end up playing for the Seahawks this year. Look, Earl Thomas went into the Cowboys locker room and told him to pick him up, and then he's acting like the Seahawks aren't being loyal. Have you ever in your life seen that happen? Ever in your life seen that happen? Where you play another team, lose to them on their field, you're walking in the locker room, and you walk into their locker room and tell their coach to pick me up when I'm available? Who does that? You can say, well, he's from Texas, and like, I've never seen that before in my life. And of course, now he wants the loyalty to play in with the Seattle Seahawks. Either play for the Seahawks or sit the whole year. I think eventually he plays because that's the only way to get paid.
Yeah, I'm with you. I think he's going to be out there because he wants the money. But the bottom line is the Legion of Boom is done. And this is one of the final straws. And I think you got to wonder, let's see what type of season Pete Carroll has, because it's kind of coming to an ugly end for him in Seattle. And I think that's a big part of
the story. Well, remember, Doug Baldwin, they just said, is going to be out for the entire preseason. Right. He's the number one target for Russell Wilson.
I mean, how much pressure is going to be put on Russell Wilson to do everything?
Speaking of players unhappy with their current situation, Le'Veon Bell is still not at Steelers training camps. Mike Tomlin says he's, quote, hopeful that he'll get to us sooner and that he'll be in better shape than he was last year. Chris, what do you expect from L. Bell this year with the Steelers?
Well, look, he's a great running back, and we saw last year he came in at the last moment, and you started slowly but got going and had a great season. I would hope he has a better start, and I'm sure that's part of what Tomlin's talking about. And I tend to think he will. Even if he comes in late, I just believe he's going to have a better start. He knows what this year means for him. You know, because, look, a lot of people are looking at this as you're getting to that age where, you know, I can understand. Some people are saying, I can understand why Pittsburgh's not going to lock you up, because what are you going to be 3 years from now? Maybe 2 years from now? You know, certainly 4 years from now. So I'm sure he wants to come out and show people, look, age is just a number. I'm still as great or actually better than ever. So I think he'll come out and have a very good year.
I think this is about the disconnect between players and coaches in terms of reality of football. It's really reality of any sport. Players believe that their off-season training, hey, look, I don't need to go to training camp. I need to put myself in harm's way. I'm working out with my guy. I'm coming in great physical condition. The difference is, are you in football shape, right? You can run through cones. You can lift. You can do sprints. You can do agility. You can do karaoke. You can do all that different stuff that you do when you're training, you're loosening up and doing yoga, and you look great. But what Mike Tomlin's saying is, like, look, you might have looked like you're in great shape, you might have worked out, but you weren't in great football shape. And look, to L. Bell's defense, he didn't get the ball early in the year. Frankly, they didn't give him the ball enough in the playoffs. That's one of the reasons that Todd Haley was relieved of his duties and he's no longer their offensive coordinator. But if the message is being sent that last year you weren't in football shape, you need to come in a little bit earlier than you did, even if you skip camp, get into football shape. And, oh, yeah, by the way, we change offensive coordinators and we want to build around you. But we can't build around you if you're not here. So you have to get here. That's what he's challenging L. Bell on.
All right. Another day. Another puzzling social media post by Kevin Durant. During our KD discussion yesterday,
this
Chris,
is Groundhog Day, isn't
you
it?
Mentioned that Durant texted you saying, the guy you see now is the real me. The guy in OKC was the phony. I was just trying to please everybody. Well, after our social media team put that clip out there on Twitter, an OKC fan chimed in. My name is Kaylee tweeted, well, the guy you are now is a clown that no one respects or takes seriously. To which Durant responded, here's the clout you ordered. Enjoy. Chris, your thoughts on KD's continued use of social media?
First of all, I'm not sure what that tweet meant. Here's the clout you ordered. Enjoy.
Attention?
Yeah, maybe. Why would he give it to her, though?
I don't know.
I don't know what he meant. But I'm going to say this. Look. It doesn't look good. KD responded to just random fans on Twitter and all that. It makes him look sensitive, and we know he hates that. But I'm going to say this. It matters. It depends on what type of person you are. You have to know who you are. Now, when I covered the New York Knicks for the New York Times, there were players that would not read the papers. because in New York it was so critical, the tabloids and all that, that they just stayed away from it because they knew they didn't want the voices in their head, right? LeBron James, I think, remember, after his meltdown against Dallas in the finals, that's when he began going zero dark 30 in the playoffs the following season. The rest is history. He didn't like that stuff being in his head. On the other side, Michael Jordan was a guy that loved the slights and loved the criticism and used it and even made some up to motivate himself. So it depends on what type of person you are. So I'm going to say this about Durant. If he is the type of person that can engage with all of these critics on social media, no matter how big or small they are, and still go out and be the best player in the world, arguably, or the second best player in the world, and still lead his team to win championships, then I have to admit, I'm fine with it. We might think it's immature. We might think it's foolish. We might think it's not befitting of an MVP and so on and so forth. But if he can still go out and ball,
it doesn't matter.
I mean, you know?
Yeah, I understand that. Honest question, okay? You've been in this business for a long time. Is there any hesitance in what you said yesterday where it wasn't a text, it was a DM, right? It was a DM.
I don't know what the difference is, but yeah.
Well, a DM is kind of, it's supposed to kind of be private, right?
Not any more than a text.
Okay, but would you share a text if you're texting back and forth with
KD? If there's something that I felt like I could share, and no one said off the record in our conversation, and I didn't think this was inflammatory. If it's something inflammatory, I'm going to go to the person before and say, look, I want to use this. You cool with it?
Did you go with him?
No, because it wasn't inflammatory. I asked KD, the guy I see now is different than the guy I saw in Oklahoma City.
Right.
So it looks like you kind of being phony.
Look,
I'm not being phony. This is the real me.
I'm not saying the fact that you communicated with him and that he gave you. I'm just wondering the process.
Now, players who I talk to, players, coaches, executives, they know that I don't just spill beans. And when we having a confidential conversation, an off-the-record conversation, no issue. Yeah. This, no.
Yeah, no, he didn't come at you like you were C.J. McCollum.
No.
So here.
I don't think KD minds. This is the real me. I don't think he minds.
And he has said that. This is the real me. Right. I'm tired of it. I'm not taking it anymore. No. Here's my advice to Kevin Durant. I actually love your take because I'd never heard that take before, which is like, look, if this is what fuels you, then let it fuel you. Don't let it take away your edge. But man, Seth Davis gave me some great advice one day. Mute button. Everybody, somehow it's you're a bad person when you block people. Just mute them. That way they can make their comments and they don't know that no one can see it in your timeline. Right. You know, it's not even that you reply, but you're giving them a platform. When you put it on your feed, he's got over 17 million followers.
That's the crazy thing to me. And Chris brought this up in our morning meeting. He's got over 17 million Twitter followers, over 10 million Instagram. How does he even see these comments, mentions?
There's a way in which certain people, because he has responded to this fan previously on Twitter. This one, I am Kaylee, whatever fan, he's actually gone back and forth with her previously.
But look, would he have her?
Yeah, you would think.
You can get the notifications.
I don't know. It's somebody who used to be a friend. Like, look, I actually think that Oklahoma City people look really, really small in this thing. Like, calling somebody.
If you look back at the thing, she's done.
I still do radio in Oklahoma City. I got my start there in Oklahoma City, and I love the passion for sports. But you have to understand the hypocrisy in the idea of we love you, we love you, we love you. You play for somebody else. You decide to leave as a free agent, and all of a sudden, now you're an idiot. Now you're a clown.
On top of everything he had done.
But wait. I was the best before, and now I'm the worst. Like how that? If you know, whereas normal human beings, we're still friends. You know, we work together at a different place. Yep. I left. We were still friends. We come and work in the same place. We're still friends. Like that's usually how it works. So I understand that. I think Kevin Durant is struggling with that. Was struggling with fandom, fandom of Oklahoma City, fandom of other NBA teams. But just press the mute button. The mute is this soft way in between that and block. And mute, just don't give them the platform. I don't understand why, if somebody wants to be a hater and call you a clown, you can reply to them. You can. You can direct message them. But when you retweet their tweet, you're giving them 17 million followers. to then respond to.
But that's almost what he said. Do we think, and that's an excellent point, has he ever come out and said that he dislikes the Twitter interaction?
No, he said he likes it. He said this is how I am in my real life.
So maybe he just
I talk back at people
and should mute it. Maybe he's not bothered by it.
Maybe he enjoys the back and forth.
All right, this is going to sound super super arrogant, but don't care. Okay, look, Kevin Durant, they're civilians. You're a superhero. You don't have to always interact with civilians. They don't know what they don't even know what they don't know. But you might think, hey, all I am is showing the world what they don't know. It's not doing you any justice. You're a two-time NBA Finals MVP. You're the MVP of the league. You got great new shoes, which, by the way, super comfortable. Wore them to play hoop the other day. Don't have them on today. What do you just mute them?
But here's the thing again. If KD's not bothered by it, if it hasn't negatively impacted his game,
it negatively impacts his image, though.
Maybe he doesn't care.
But look at a lot of people's image. I mean, look, there are players.
Everybody
domestic
cares.
Violence. There's players in trouble.
I got it. But do you think
this is a guy responding to people that? And
do you think it's
honest,
a good look? Do you think it's a good look?
No, I don't. But when I really have to look at it and evaluate, I don't think it's a good look. But when I look at it, I'm like, what's really the big deal? And when we think about Twitter and social media, part of it is that you do get to interact with the fans.
Yes.
And they have access to you. So if you're the type of person as a public figure that wants to interact with them, I wouldn't do it, I don't like it, but hey, it's not a crime.
Comedian Bill Burr. You know the comedian Bill Burr? Okay, Bill Burr had this bit about the malice at the palace. Right. And his thing was, you know, for years, people had always taunted NBA players. Come up here. Come up here. You know what? They came up there and Ron Artest took out a whole roll of people. It's a great bit. Go ahead, check it out online. And that's essentially what's happening. Right. You know, you think like I'm a tweet at KD, tweet at him. And suddenly he claps back at you. And you're like, oh, you said come up here. And now he just claps back at you. You do look at a clown. I just don't whether or not you say you don't care about your image. You do. Everybody wants to be liked, or if not liked, you want to be respected. And your peer group, other NBA players, are looking at their phones like, man, what is KD doing? Why are you engaging with these people who all they want to do is bring you stress and try and bring you down? Like, dude, it's the offseason. Turn that thing off or just press mute.
KD, go get your 29 points and your 7 or 8 rebounds.
Keep putting your
rings
on.
As long as you're doing that,
put some more rings
on. Get the
on.
Rings and we cool.
Coming up, which rookie quarterback is way behind his competition? The answer is next on First Things First. We're back here on First Things First, and Super Bowl champ Chris Canty is here.
Sarah, I'm trying to get it together right now, the conversation we were having off air.
I'm just trying to get it together,
collect my thoughts, and focus.
I got to focus.
Wait. What did you do last night? Sarah called a WNBA game in Connecticut.
I shut it down early last night.
Did you?
Well, I mean, the Yankees and the Mets had their game, so I just shut it down early.
You were watching the game?
No. I was watching my eyelids when that game was on. You did look fabulous, though.
So he hears.
We're moving on.
No shade.
Let's talk about Jets rookie quarterback Sam Darnold. The number 3 overall pick out of USC has been at camp since Monday following a contract dispute. Darnold, certainly the future of the Jets, but is he the present? He's battling both Josh McCown and Teddy Bridgewater for the starting job, and Darnold is fully aware that he, quote, has some catching up to do. Chris, despite being behind the competition, should Darnold start Week 1 for the Jets?
No, he shouldn't start Week 1, and I'm going to tell you guys why. Even though his talent presents more upside in the way of winning than the other quarterbacks on the roster, the Jets opened the season with 3 games in 10 days. And Sam Darnold only played 3 years of quarterback in his life, 1 as a senior in high school and then 2 at USC. So I have a hard time believing that he's going to be up to speed and acclimated to the NFL game to the point where you're putting him in to give him the best chance to be successful. I don't think that's going to be Week 1. Now, at some point in his rookie season, is he going to be the starting quarterback? Absolutely, because we haven't seen a rookie quarterback drafted in the first round not play in his rookie season since Aaron Rodgers, and that's 2005. So I think that the Jets organization, they have to be smart about the timing and when to insert Sam Darnold in the starting lineup, but I don't think that's going to happen early on in the season.
Now, let me ask you this. If in camp and preseason, he's clearly the most impressive and the best quarterback, you still wouldn't start him in Week 1 just because of what you said?
Well, I think that You have to judge it. It's a case-by-case basis, not one size fits all. So if Todd Bowles and the coaching staff feel like he's ready, then you have to play him because you have a responsibility to the other guys in the locker room. They can see, too, what's going on the practice field.
Can't fool players.
And if Josh McCown and Teddy Bridgewater are nowhere close to Sam Darnold, then you got to play him. But I don't think that'll be the case. Just because Josh McCown has been around longer than Teddy Bridgewater and Sam Darnold, he's probably got more of a rapport, more chemistry with the receivers and the skill position players, which aren't great, but serviceable. So I'm looking at the requisite talent on that offense, offensive line, skill position players, and I'm thinking to myself, I don't know that Sam Darnold is evolved enough as a quarterback to be able to elevate the play of all of those guys the first week of the season. I don't think that will be the case, but we'll have to see.
And there's some other elements to it, aren't there, in terms of locker room culture, right? Like, look, Teddy Bridgewater is a guy that's not a chump, and he may well earn the right to start a couple of games. But I think the biggest thing is this. In addition to the fact that he's inexperienced in terms of game hours, game action during the time at USC and the limited time playing at San Clemente High School, it's that once you start him, you can't then go sit him, right? Because you run the risk of ruining his confidence. Instead, have him sit, have him watch, have him learn from McCown, even have him learn from Bridgewater, knowing he's going to be the guy eventually. And I guess here's the other question becomes, in addition to the fact you can't sit him, once you play him, aren't you, at least on some levels, waving the white flag on the season? And Todd Bowles, a guy who needs to win now, more likely to win with the veteran quarterback, whereas when you play the rookie quarterback, you're playing for the future. And players, I'm more interested in the psychology of a player. You play the rookie, are you waving the white flag on the season?
No, you're not waving the white flag on the season because Sam Darnold has more talent than Josh McCown and probably has more talent than Teddy Bridgewater. So you're in your mind, as the coach and more so as the general manager, you think that he gives you a better chance to win. Now, it's just a matter of when is he ready to go out there and operate the offense. There's always going to be a learning curve when playing the quarterback position. I actually asked Eli Manning about this Monday when I was out at Giants training camp. How much is it valued in terms of being able to get experience as a rookie quarterback so you know the things that you have to work on and improve as you continue to go along? And Eli Manning, because he played his rookie season, The Giants started Kirk Warner. They were 5-4. They pulled him. They put Eli in. He said that even though he didn't have a lot of success, it was important for him to get that experience so he could then take the next step.
But that's 10 games in, right? So is there a magic number, or is it just a sense? Is it a feel?
I think it's a feel thing as the regular season goes along. But make no mistake about it, I think that Sam Darnold has to play this year. It's just a matter of when that time is right for
this
team.
Is it playbook? Is it timing? Is it understanding? Well, what do you feel more so than anything else, Sarah,
it's about being able to process information in real time. So being able to get up to the line of scrimmage, understand the play you got called from the huddle, diagnosing the defense, making sure that you get your team in the right looks, the right protections, all of those things, and then executing the offense. A lot about quarterbacking in the NFL is about pre-snap reads. So if Sam Darnold isn't at the stage in his development where he can recognize those things and then operate the offense, get in and out of the huddle, in and out of different plays, down in, down out, then you can't put him out there because that's going to be just a detriment of not only your offense, but your defense as well. It's all complementary.
I think this, Chris, and I get what you're saying about, you know, late in the season, we probably will see Darnold and should. And if he's ready in week one, put him in there and go for it. But I don't think it'd be the worst thing in the world because of his lack of experience. He's 20 years old. He doesn't have the experience of Rosen and Baker Mayfield. Mm-hmm. I don't think it'd be the worst thing in the world if he didn't play this year. And you have him ready for next year. Like, next year's the target. If he's not quite ready, let's say, you know, they won 5 games and surprised people. I know that sounds funny, but 5 games and surprised people last year. What if they're, you know, knocking on the door 500 or playing 500 football? Bridgewater maybe is in there and looking pretty good. I don't think it'd be the worst thing if he's ready for next year. Carson Palmer, I think, didn't play as a rookie either, in addition to Rodgers. So, you know, I think this is a unique situation where he only had 2 years at USC. Like you said, 1 year in high school, where it wouldn't be the worst thing if he played next
year. It's the Jets, though, now. I mean, this is New York City.
Right? I get it.
It's the Jets in New York City. They moved mountains to get him. They made a trade that was a terrible trade. I mean, the fact that the Giants were so dumb they took a running back instead of a franchise quarterback. Let's just call it. Like,
I agree.
Like, look,
do you think he should start week one?
No, but I don't even know. What you're saying is not wrong. Okay, what you're saying is right. But the reality of the world in which we live in is the Jets made a terrible trade, and somehow the Giants decided to take a running back, and the Browns took Baker Mayfield, who truthfully is probably a second-round talent, number one overall. I mean, things like this never happen to the Jets, ever. It happens to the Giants, or it happens to the Yankees, right? This is a godsend. And so in order to continue to invigorate your fan base on the future, you have to play him. It ain't an if, it's a
win. It has to be somewhere between Christian Hackenberg and Mark Sanchez, right?
Correct.
Maybe not the week one starter, but you can't sit him his entire rookie year.
I'm saying wrong.
It depends on the circumstances.
You got to get him some experience. You have to have that happen.
Do they have any chance?
Because you can't have a question mark about your quarterback position if you're the New York Jets going into 2019.
I agree with
you. You got to see what you have and that commodity, what you invested all that draft capital in. You got to find out what he is before you get to next offseason, because you got to put the talent.
He's got to be the starter.
The Jets got a lot of cap space and free agency next year, so they've got to be able to put the requisite talent around him to be able to help him, but they got to know what they got first.
All right, Chris, stick around. Coming up, do the Eagles have a huge problem on their hands when it comes to Carson Wentz? That's next. Back here on First Things First with Chris Canty. The Eagles may be Super Bowl champs, but there's still a lot of questions surrounding the team, most notably about how their star quarterback Carson Wentz will recover from a torn LCL and ACL. First week of training camp, Wentz participated in 11-on-11 work, but that has stopped. However, head coach Doug Peterson said the team is just being careful.
I'm very encouraged, obviously, where he's at. And what I saw last week is enough to ease my mind. I don't need to see him in 11-on-11 drills right now. He's progressing extremely well. I don't want to subject him to any kind of, you know, a setback or anything like that. I want to keep him, progressive and moving forward. And those couple of days that we had with him were very exciting, very encouraging for me.
Chris, how cautious should the Eagles be with Carson Wentz?
Well, they should be extremely cautious. And I'm going to translate exactly what Doug Peterson just said by him not needing to see Carson Wentz in 11-on-11 drills. He's not going to be the week one quarterback. He's not going to start week one. Just because it's nonsensical, you already have a capable backup. Nick Foles won Super Bowl MVP. He went 5-1 as a starter. He's capable with this group. So you recognize how deep your roster is. You also see that your schedule in the first month of the season is not exactly murderer's row. So you have an opportunity to buy some time and give Carson Wentz as much time as necessary to get healed up and ready to go when you put him in. And, Doug, you talked about this with Sam Darnold. When you put him in, you can't go back. Same thing with Carson Wentz, just because he is the future at the quarterback position for the Philadelphia Eagles franchise. So I think Doug Peterson, the coaching staff, the medical staff, they have a plan. They're going to stick to it. A big part of why I think Carson Wentz didn't start the training camp on the PUP list was because I think you have to have a carrot that's dangling out there for players to continue to keep them motivated. But that being said now, and being in the second week of camp, I think we all recognize that Carson Wentz is not going to be ready by the start of the regular season. He's still got some rust that he's got to shake off. He still doesn't look like himself. And listen, Carson Wentz acknowledged that the medical staff hasn't cleared him for physical contact. So it's going to take some time with him, but there's no rush.
And at this point, it's, 7 months since the injury? Usually it's 9 to 12 months before you're ready. And I also think with Nick Foles, heck, even if they start 4-1 with Nick Foles or whatever, Foles is not going to trip when they remove him from the starting lineup and put in Carson Wentz, and neither will the teammates. They're not going to say, hold on, this guy led us to a Super Bowl. We could keep, because they know they can win with Wentz as well. He proved it last year. So I'm with you. There's no pressure at all on them to put him in prematurely. So they're in a good spot.
I think it's really a fascinating look at the different psychology of different players. You know, we've talked a lot about the Celtics and how will that all work out when Kyrie Irving is back and Gordon Hayward is back and Jason Tatum will have to take a secondary or maybe even a tertiary role. The difference here is Nick Foles is the perfect guy for this spot. Granted, winning a Super Bowl really, really helps. But the fact that he had the job in Philadelphia before, he had the job in St. Louis that he lost, he was out of football. He did get a little bit of a pay bump in the offseason to continue to keep him happy. They didn't trade him. I think he's the one guy who you could say, you know what, I'm going to be okay. letting Carson Wentz come back whenever he's ready. Like, he's the one guy. It doesn't work 95% of the time because everybody has an ego. You're like, look, I'm playing well. I won a Super Bowl. Now you're going to take me out? Mm-hmm. But this is the one guy to which I actually believe it. I actually think it will work when Carson Wentz comes back.
Carson Wentz has said to Doug Peterson that it's all about the medical staff, and the medical staff says he's ready. But do you think for Wentz himself that he'll continue to start getting more and more anxious once the season actually starts and he'll start putting some pressure on the organization to get back out there?
Well, I'm sure he will, and he's probably already putting pressure on the organization, which is why they didn't put him on the PUP list to start training camp.
Right.
When you see your backup get crowned Super Bowl MVP, it puts a little bit of a chip on your shoulder. Carson Wentz was playing as good as any quarterback in the National Football League when he got hurt in November. So, I mean, you look at it and you say, okay, this is a situation where we don't want to rush you. We know what you're capable of. We know you can be a quarterback that plays at an MVP level, but we can't risk your long-term health just because we recognize how much we've got invested in you. They got a lot of draft capital invested in Carson Wentz. They traded a lot to move up to get him. So you got to make sure that you protect that investment by making sure he's as healthy as possible when you put him back out there on the field. And for his confidence, you know, when you have a knee reconstruction, the only time you're going to get really, really confident about what happened and being fully back is when you get hit on that knee a few times. And the fact that he hasn't been cleared by the medical staff for physical contact means that the organization is not comfortable putting him in that situation.
Does it matter if you start him at home, on the road, against a difficult defense? You mentioned how their schedule is kind of soft out of the chute, right? I mean, third game of the year is against the Colts. I look at the Colts, and that's the team that, just talent-wise, I would most like to play against.
I don't want that matchup against the Jaguars in October.
I don't want that one. Out of the bye week, that's all the way in November if you hold off that long. I don't think you hold off that long, but if you do, that's the Dallas Cowboys. Like, their schedule gets progressively more difficult. So if you were to find, like, a perfect landing spot, is it a home game? Is it against a team with a soft defense? What's the magical mix to the right team to make Carson Wentz comfortable in his first start?
If I think he's an MVP type quarterback, then it doesn't matter. Yes. Whether it's on the road, whether it's at home, whether it's against a difficult opponent, it shouldn't matter. Again, the Jacksonville Jaguars, I think that's a little bit different of an animal just because their defensive front. Nasty. They get after the quarterback. I don't want to put a quarterback just coming off of a knee reconstruction around that type of defense because, to me, that's one of the best defenses, if not the best defense in the NFL. But at some point, Carson Wentz is going to be inserted in the starting lineup.
There's been a lot of trash talk out of Philadelphia, and we have seen it. Now, usually it's the team that loses the Super Bowl that suffers from the Super Bowl hangover. Okay, but there's a lot of trash talk at their victory parade. You got Lane Johnson talking trash about the Patriots, how it's no fun. Like, look, it's great, but they were very close to losing to the Atlanta Falcons at home, and there's a completely different narrative about Philadelphia if they lose that game, right? So, I mean, I understand that they've done a great job of turning over that roster and having more talent than people in that division, but a lot of things went their way. Ezekiel Elliott gets suspended. That helps. Odell Beckham Jr. and all the wide receivers for the New York Giants get hurt. That helps. And they got a little fortunate early in the playoffs. That helps. So that you know, ultimately you win a Super Bowl. I'm fascinated to see how this – now they're the hunted instead of the hunter. I'll be fascinated to see if they got a little too fat and sassy, talk too much trash, whereas everybody's coming loaded for bear.
You do worry about that a little bit being the case, a Super Bowl hangover. But when you look at your starting quarterback, he really didn't win the Super Bowl, right? When you look at Michael Bennett, who they bought over from the Seattle Seahawks, he didn't win the Super Bowl in Philadelphia. Haloti Ngata, he didn't win the Super Bowl in Detroit. So, I mean, you look at a lot of guys coming onto that team, they have something to prove with the Philadelphia Eagles. Mike Wallace, another receiver.
I think
he's an upgrade over Torrey Smith. He didn't win the Super Bowl, when he was at his last stop. So, I mean, you look at these players that they're bringing in, there's an influx of talent. I think they've done a great job of turning over the roster. And you mentioned the injuries from the other teams in the NFC East. I think Philadelphia has benefited from having one of the deeper rosters in the NFL. That's attributed to Howie Roseman.
Well, their injuries, too. They got a lot of other players besides Wentz coming back. They have a lot of reasons to think, you know what, we're better than the team that won the Super Bowl.
Jason Peters will be back.
Yeah, so that they got a lot of motivation for that.
You'll be back, too. Go get a coffee. Have you back in a little bit. Coming up, is James Harden way too optimistic about playing with Carmelo? That's next on First Things First.
Now you...
Carmelo Anthony officially a Houston Rocket? Well, almost. Melo's incredible career with the Atlanta Hawks has come to a close as the team waived him, clearing the way for him to sign with Houston. While it's up for debate as to how much better Melo makes the Rockets, James Harden isn't worried, saying, quote, eventually we'll figure it out. Chris, how hard will it be for the Rockets to figure it out with Melo?
It's a challenge. I mean, he just is not Mike D'Antoni's type of offensive player. But D'Antoni, I do think, is an offensive genius. And he figured out a way to make Chris Paul and James Harden work. I was skeptical at this time last year that those two could fit together. And Chris Paul put up the same numbers he's basically put up his entire career in D'Antoni's system. So I think D'Antoni can figure out a way to make it work. I like that Melo gives him a mid-range game to go with Chris Paul, because other than Chris Paul, they had no mid-range shooters last year. We saw in the clip, he's got that post game that they can go to when they want to. They may have, they'll have several different schemes probably, because they typically don't feature any type of post score last year, right? But maybe they'll have a scheme where at times they go to Melo down there when Capella's not, you know, near the basket and stuff like that. The thing I like is that Melo has no leverage. Okay, this is, you have to play well here. You have to do as you're told, so to speak, or you're making $2 million a year. They can cut you, get rid of you, cut bait, whatever. So I like that. And they didn't get along, Melo and D'Antoni in New York. But Melo had all the leverage then. D'Antoni had none. Now it's the absolute opposite. D'Antoni has all the leverage, all the juice. Melo has to play nice and fit in. So I think it can work.
Couples that get divorced and then sometimes get remarried, right? There are Pam and Tommy Lee, right? What ends up happening is, like, oh, you're back together and you remember all the things that you liked about the person that caused you to want to marry them to begin with. But then at some point, you know, at some point you're like, oh, yeah, I remember why we got divorced. So I kind of think that's going to be the case here for the Rockets. I don't think for the most part the regular season it'll be sticky. I don't, because Carmelo Anthony can really score. Yeah. This is a tremendous team. And, look, he said he didn't fit in Oklahoma City because he didn't have time to do so. He had training camp in 82 games. Like, what more time do you actually need? But I do think at some point it's going to come to a head, whether he's making league minimum or not, because he got bought out by the Atlanta Hawks. At some point, it's, will Carmelo Anthony's ego allow him to watch the Rockets finish a big game with him on the bench and P.J. Tucker in there, right? Like, P.J. Tucker was a really good player at Texas, has been kind of a middling NBA player, but he fits what they want. He can guard a bunch of positions. He's tougher. He's tougher than a $2 steak, and occasionally he hits a corner jump shot. Like,
and what if they get Kent Bazemore? I mean, that's just talk
right
now.
That changes the entire complexion of everything.
That's another guy that's going to be playing.
I understand. So the idea is, like, it sounds good, and I do think there will be times in which he's making shots, and he's boys, and I'm sure Chris Paul went to Mike D'Antoni, and he's like, look, he's my guy. I'll take care of it. I'll handle it. I can handle Melo. He's my guy. Banana boat forever, right? But the reality is, at some point, we're going to remember why Melo has bounced team to team, and we're especially, Mike D'Antoni and Melo are going to remember why they got divorced to begin with. That will happen, because Carmelo just can't bring it upon himself to watch other people play, because in his heart, he knows he's a Hall of Famer. He should be out there. But at this point in his career, the way the NBA has played, I don't know if you can hide two guys who can't guard. You can already hide James Harden not playing defense. Yeah. Can you hide two guys? I don't think the answer is yes.
Are we also overlooking, I say we universally, but keep talking about, oh, Carmelo could anchor the second unit. He can be that scorer. He can be the guy that they
He should want to.
But are we overlooking Eric Gordon? Like, Gordon's role of, that was when he got his shots.
That I think at when this he, point, Gordon is a higher option. If you had to have first option,
absolutely.
Harden, second option, Chris Paul, Eric Gordon's the third option, you know, and then if you want to throw Capella somewhere in there, like, Melo just has to accept this. He has to realize, look, nobody's going to look down at you. Nobody's going to say, oh, you weren't as great as we thought you were. Nobody's going to say, you know, Melo's not a Hall of Famer. If in your 16th year, you're a role player averaging 12 points a game, on a Western Conference finalist or an NBA champion.
Dude, that sounds really good until you're sitting there, okay, and you're supposed to cheer and support your teammates, and Chris Paul and James Harden and Eric Gordon and P.J. Tucker and Clint Capella are out there, and they're sitting down, and you're supposed to be in the huddle, you know, clapping and dapping.
You can't tell
me that. That sounds great, but this is all he's done his whole life.
I get it.
His whole life, at the end of a game, it's been throw it to Melo. And if Melo can win it for us or Melo can lose it for us. And last year was the first time that he wasn't the number one option. And there was some talk about coming off the bench. Like, he should want to come off the bench because he can dominate.
He would get his points even if he's second.
He'd get way more looks. But the reality, you're talking about a sacrifice of ego that to this point in his life, he has never shown. And look, that doesn't make you a bad person. It makes you a human being, especially makes you a guy. And it's one of the things that's made him great. Ultimately, may make him fail in this
particular
instance.
Some guys have done it. Bill Walton, Bob McAdoo. Now, maybe injuries, you know, with Walton, but still, Ray Allen. You know, now he was in late in games in Miami, but you know, a lot of guys have done it.
Yes, and a lot of guys, and Allen Iverson could not. Yeah. A lot of guys.
He could end up going out like AI.
But Kobe could never find a 2.0 or a 3.0, and Melo is struggling to find that 2.0.
Right.
It'll be interesting to watch. Coming up, will the latest Pats injury be too much for Tom Brady to overcome? That is next on First Things First. First, and we are going viral. Reports broke yesterday that Tristan Thompson sucker punched Draymond Green at LeBron's SB after party, and the city of Cleveland was ready to throw Tristan a parade. But Draymond took to Instagram to set the story straight, saying, quote, "I've enjoyed y'all's stories and talk shows over the last couple days. Them joints inaccurate. Carry on, my good people. They may want to cancel that parade too, LOL." Following that up with a quote, "Nah, keep the parade. That city won't have any for a while. I forgot Brown left."
Ow. You forgot the doji. Doji.
Kicking with.
Mad inaccurate doji. That's what he said.
I'm not that cool. I can barely keep up with that.
Kick them when they're down. Draymond likes to kick when you're up.
Period. Right.
Kick them when you're down.
Do you think Tristan's getting a kick out of this at all, or no? You think?
Yeah, because it looks like Tristan's mad tough. I mean, he supposedly punched him. Now they're saying he kind of mushed him.
He mushed him.
Would you rather be mushed? Or actually punched?
No, what would I rather be? I'd rather be neither, but...
if you had to choose.
I'd rather be mushed.
Do you feel like that's more disrespectful?
Punching a dude is like, punching, like we're going to go down, we have to throw down.
Right.
You punch a guy, you have to punch back, or it has to be a fight. If somebody mushes somebody, now it becomes a shoving match.
Exactly.
Hold me back.
If you mush me, I can laugh it off like, man, you ain't nothing, you know. But if you punch me...
It is amazing, though.
Well, then you
can
fight back. Mushing just feels disrespectful, but then what are you going to do back?
And you can laugh about like, man.
It is amazing. Draymond Green, a Michigan State football player wanted to fight him. I think it was last offseason at a bar. Yeah. Now it's Tristan Thompson. Like, this is kind of a thing. Like Dre, like you talk that much trash. Dudes, there are going to be
Charles
guys that
Barkley.
Blow up. Yes.
He's the one who said it. All right, time for stories to start your morning. According to reports, the much-anticipated Tiger Woods-Phil Mickelson one-on-one match for $10 million is on and scheduled for Thanksgiving weekend. It will all go down to Chattel Creek Golf Course in Las Vegas. Doug, who do you have your money on?
Tiger. There's a genius to Tiger Woods here. This is like Floyd Mayweather taking on Manny Pacquiao.
Right.
Floyd Mayweather waited until Manny Pacquiao, one, he had the bad shoulder, but two, he was over the hill. Waited like 3 extra years before he'd ever fight that fight, so it wasn't a fair fight. Tiger Woods came back. Tiger Woods is still, he's not in his prime, but he's still competitive at the top of the golf world. I don't believe Phil Mickelson is. They'll both make a lot of money. I wish it was winner take all. That's what I want. I want boxing matches to be winner take all. I want golf matches to be winner take all. That's the idea of a purse. Whoever wins gets the purse.
I'm with Tiger, but I just love the idea of this. I want to see more of these going forward in golf. And I think there's another element to the Floyd Mayweather. This is tremendous marketing. And this is, I think Tiger's getting his confidence back. But this Floyd Mayweather is not fighting the young warriors in the welterweight division that could really give him some problems at his advanced age. He's picking and choosing these big time things that make a ton of money, and you know, and I can win. And that's what I think Tiger's doing in this. If I can't win a major or a tournament, I can beat Phil Mickelson and get $10 million.
Correct. Floyd Mayweather never fought a fight the last 6 years that he couldn't. He didn't win before he ever stepped in the ring. I mean, he fights Conor McGregor. Had never been in a boxing match in his life.
And we all paid and watched.
Yes, we did.
Moving on to hoops, former Louisville coach Rick Pitino announced he has a memoir coming out in September that will, quote, lay all his cards on the table. Doug,
probably not
got a lot
the
to cover
sentence.
There, huh?
Probably not the sentence. Laying anything on the table is probably not the sentence. Didn't come out like Rick Pitino wanted to come out. Will I read it? Absolutely. Rick Pitino, for my money, is the best modern-day basketball coach.
Really?
Period. Think about the things he brought to the NBA. He embraced the three-point shot before anybody else did. Then when he's in Boston, they tanked before tanking was even a thing. Of course, it didn't work. They didn't get Tim Duncan in that draft, and he traded away Chauncey Billups before the first year was complete. But he brought the three-point shot to the NBA and embraced it. Up-tempo basketball as well, and then he tanked before tanking was cool. And then all the different incarnations of him as a coach. He's a masterful basketball coach. He also paid more attention to conditioning and as that a part of the culture of your program before anybody else did. Like Tiger Woods brought that to golf. He brought it to basketball. I think he's a masterful basketball coach. But is he really going to tell us where the bodies are buried? If he does, it'll be a bestseller. But he'll never coach again, and this dude wants to coach again. I'm guessing this book will fall short because it'll paint the picture that he wants us to see.
I was going to say, he's not going to tell us where the bodies are buried. What he's going to do is try to write something that exonerates him. I mean, he's gone, you know, and look, to his credit, if I were accused of those things, especially, I mean, I think he's guilty, but if I was innocent, I'm going to my grave trying to fight it. So I give him credit for that. I also think, like you say, he's a great coach. I think he's more of a college coach. Had success with the Knicks early on, and you're right, they were exciting, fun to watch. Obviously, it didn't go as well later in his tenure there and in Boston, but terrific college basketball coach.
Moving on to football, Le'Veon Bell is still not at Steelers training camp. Mike Tomlin says he's, quote, hopeful that he'll get to us sooner and that he'll be in better shape than he was last year. Chris, what do you expect from L. Bell this year with the Steelers?
I expect L. Bell to have a great season, maybe even better than last year. He started slow last year. He wasn't in great shape when they started. I think he'll be ready because, look, he's talked a lot about, I mean, he did it last year too, but wanting this contract. He's seen, you know, these receivers that he's probably comparing himself to some of these receivers getting these big contracts. And he also knows that there's some thought out there that, look, you're getting a little bit older. Running backs only last so long. So I think he wants to come out and show everybody that he's still very much in his prime.
Well, listen, Le'Veon Bell's as talented as any running back in the National Football League. That's inarguable. He has had the weed suspension. He has had injury that kept him out of a playoff game. So I think, you know, NFL, they talk about availability is key, and especially when you want to get that next big contract. What Mike Tomlin is sending the message out is Le'Veon Bell thought he was in great shape because he was in great shape coming into camp last year, and he wanted to know why he didn't get the football more is because he wasn't in great football shape. You got to get here. You got to go through our new offense. You got to get in great football shape so we can give you the football week one. If there's a reason Todd Haley doesn't have his job anymore in Pittsburgh instead is in Cleveland. I mean, the reason is because they didn't utilize Le'Veon Bell enough early in the season and then in the playoffs when they lost. No other reason. Look, I don't think the Steelers are going to be nearly as good as they were last year because they don't have Ryan Shazier, but I think Le'Veon Bell is going to have a big year.
Finally, another blow to Tom Brady and the Pats receiving corps. Jordan Matthews was placed on injured reserve with a hamstring injury. They're already looking outside the organization, working out Eric Decker. Brandon Cooks traded. Danny Amendola gone. Julian Edelman suspended. Doug, do the Pats have enough weapons around Tom Brady to start the season?
Probably not, but they'll make it work anyway, right? Like, they're like, man, Wes Welker goes to Denver. Like, oh, we got Danny Amendola who couldn't stay healthy. But Danny Amendola's go, oh, we got Chris Hogan now. They have Gronk. You know, look, obviously, when you're looking for fresh legs this early in training camp at wide receiver, especially with Julian Edelman out for the first four games, it does perk up your attention. But you have Sony Michel. You got James White. They've been able to utilize running backs as wide receivers as well as anybody. I put my faith not just in Brady, but in that entire coaching staff, which though there was some turnover, it was more turnover on the defensive side of the football. So on paper, probably not. But the reality is they've been through this before, and having injuries and knowing the suspension of Edelman before they ever got to training camp, I think was big so they could put in a game plan for what they were going to do during those first 4 weeks.
He doesn't need weapons. I mean, seriously, like, he turns people into weapons. Look at what, like, Wes Welker was tremendous there. What'd he do without Tom Brady? You know, this guy is just incredible. Whatever receivers they put out there, they're going to be productive. I'm not a huge Eric Decker fan. He's not Julio Jones or anything. But I think he would be wildly productive if he goes to the Patriots. I think Brady and him will have a great connection and have a great year.
Yeah, I think, you know, what do they do on third down outside of Rob Gronkowski? I mean, you mentioned Wes Welker. He was, by my estimation, Wes Welker's a Hall of Famer because he was the best. He was the best third down threat in the National Football League. You do vice coverage, which is, you know, one over the top or and one underneath, and you still couldn't stop. Put two guys on him, couldn't stop him on third down. Third down, the most important down in the NFL. Who is it? Braxton Berrios, the rookie out of Miami. Does he become the third down weapon? What do they do on third down without Julian Edelman? You can't simply force the ball to Gronk every single time.
I don't know if you guys heard, LeBron is going to the Lakers.
Really?
Yeah.
Wait, is that breaking news?
Breaking news.
Put it
underneath. And there's some applause coming around. And you know who that is? That's every team in the East. Since 2011, a LeBron James-led team has represented the East in the NBA Finals. And players now believe that they have a shot with the King in L.A. Wizards point guard John Wall says the East is, quote, wide open without LeBron. Chris, which team is the best in the East with LeBron now gone?
I want Philadelphia to be the best. I love Joel Embiid and Ben Simmons. I think both of those guys will be all-time greats. Not just perennial all-stars, but all-time greats. But I think they're a year away, maturity-wise, from being the best team in the East. I think Boston is the best. They got everything. I mean, we talked about it earlier. They do have to work it out because you're bringing back your best player in Kyrie Irving. Gordon Hayward, who is a star, comes in. Is he the second option? Or is he the third option? You know, I think it starts as second, but maybe Jason Tatum really emerges and he becomes the second option. Jaylen Brown's great. Like, there's going to have a lot to work through, but there's no one better to do it than Brad Stevens. They play defense. They've got character. They've got heart. Their offense wasn't that great last year after the injuries, but again, you're bringing back your two best offensive players, so that's going to be fine. Like, there's nothing not to like about the Boston Celtics. So I think they're the best. Toronto's going to be very tough. I think they've got a great chance to win the East right there behind Boston. Philadelphia, maybe they'll surprise me, but, you know, they still got to see what Markelle Fultz is. They lost a little bit of their shooting. So Ben Simmons still, as great as he is going to have to learn how to shoot. Milwaukee's another team that I think is going to be very good. And then, you know, Washington and Indiana will battle for fifth spot. But the East is going to be competitive and fun to watch this year.
Forgot about Milwaukee as well. I mean,
yeah, see, they're probably the fourth best team, yeah, I think.
And I think the consistency they're going to have at head coach, I think they've changed that roster for the better. I think Milwaukee's a threat. I'm with you, though. It's the Boston. The first thing I would say is that the tales of the demise of the Eastern Conference have been greatly exaggerated. Yes, LeBron leaves, and that takes Cleveland off from their chance to win it. Okay, but Cleveland probably wasn't even really the best team. Boston wasn't exactly healthy this year, and they didn't run up on Philadelphia in the playoffs, whereas Philadelphia had great confidence that they could have beaten Cleveland. Remember, they nearly lost to Indy in the first round. So I think Toronto got better. I think the Wizards got better. John Wall wasn't healthy last year. If John Wall is fully healthy and whatever he was suffering from in Las Vegas, he's recovered from. But I think changing their front line, adding Jeff Green, who brings some playoff pedigree, some championship pedigree, and you bring him off the bench, I think he gives you versatility. Like, I like Washington, and I love Boston. I don't know if Philadelphia is as good because they've lost some of that shootout. They bring back J.J., Covington, though, I think Covington showed maybe a little bit of his ceiling and some of their other ancillary pieces, which frankly, you know, carry them at times in the playoffs, are gone. But I actually think the East is getting pretty deep. It's not the West. I'm not going to sit here and argue with you that the East is equal to the West, especially at the top. But it's much deeper with good teams. When you talk about Milwaukee being a fourth team and then Indy, a team that's on the rise, and some of those other teams in the East, and the Wizards with John Wall and Brad Beal, I think it's a little bit better than the common fan would think.
To your point, I believe Boston or Toronto, if they, let's say they reach the finals.
I think it's Boston. I don't think it's close, to be honest with you.
Okay. I think either of those teams, though, if they get to the finals against Golden State, I think they give the Warriors a tougher series than Cleveland did last year.
No question.
Because they got Boston defenders, well, they can switch stuff.
That's the genius to what Boston has done. And you remember when they made the trade for Kyrie, or when they acquired Gordon Hayward, they said the same thing when they made the trade for Kyrie Irving, which is it fits within our timeline and also within our style of play. Yeah. What they have done is not just draft well and fleece people for draft picks. They've drafted versatile forwards who can defend multiple positions, right? You go back 2 years ago when they had the best record, that was really the best record out of effort and going for it when other teams didn't go for it. But they had too many small guards, and you get caught up. Small guys get eaten up in this league, as you know. Right now, like, the smallest guy they're going to throw out there is Terry Rozier, and his heart is bigger than the rest of his body, right? I mean, Kyrie Irving's
and
not a great...
he's not tiny.
No, he's not Isaiah Thomas, right? Marcus Smart can defend everybody but maybe a center, and he'd take a center out in the back alley and fight him. The rest of their players are all capable of guarding one through four positions. And that's the genius to it, because it matches up well with the Golden State Warriors. That was the flaw to the Cavs, which was they didn't have... 2 years ago, they didn't have anybody other than LeBron James who could guard Kevin Durant.
I think we're in agreement about where things may fall, but when you look at the play, it was always LeBron, the best player in the Eastern in the league, but in the Eastern Conference. Who do you expect the most out of when you look at Giannis, Ben Simmons, Joel Embiid, Kawhi Leonard? Out of the East, what player are you most excited to see that you think could have the biggest impact?
Well, this is, and I'm going to tip a cap to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, right? Every player's circumstances is, in fact, different.
Okay.
Like, Kyrie Irving might well be the best player in the East, but he's not going to have the best numbers in the East because he has a bunch of other guys that need the basketball that are going to get shots. I think Giannis is most likely to have the most statistically dominant season because the team is built around, they're trying to put pieces around to space out a virtually unguardable guy when he can make a jump shot. I think Kawhi, of course, is a two-way player, and I'll be interested to see how they use him. Like, DeMar averaged 23 a game. I think he's a little bit better. He's much better defensively and probably a little bit better offensively. I think, you know, 24, 25 points a game, that's about right for Kawhi if he's healthy. I mean, those are the top three in my mind.
Neither one of the Philadelphia guys.
I love Simmons, okay, but I do think that, and maybe it's how people guard you in the postseason, I do think he's been exposed a little bit, and people know to put a big guy on him and sag off in the lane. And when he gets to your body, you got to have length on him. Embiid's the one they're kind of going to split votes, right? Embiid and Simmons. But I just don't know if Embiid's going to play every night. If I'm Philadelphia, why would I play him every night? I need him for the playoffs. I don't need to wear him out in the regular season. Play him 60-some-odd games so that you know you have him in the postseason, and so I don't think you'll have as dominant a regular season as the others.
Well, they're going to have to get to a point, though, where you can put him out there and not worry. I mean, obviously, anybody can get hurt anytime, but they've got to get to a point where you can just like any other player, you just play him. And I think you have to realize, look, if he gets hurt, he was going to get hurt at some point. And you just got to play him. Hopefully, he's at that point where he can be penciled in for 80 games, you know. And if he does that, I mean, like you said, Giannis, Kawhi, they got some great players.
Like I said, there's better players in the East than people give you. Yeah, Here's the thing. Yeah. If I'm Joel Embiid, if I'm advising Joel Embiid, you have to take a page out of the book of LeBron James. One of the only question mark is his body. And NBA guys are like, look, we don't know what he ate, how he was raised, his first 18 years of life. And when he got to Kansas, American food, like, he took advantage. And then during his couple years off, he gained some weight, and they had to get rid of some of that bad weight. Invest in yourself. Hire a chef. Hire a nutritionist. Only eat what they tell you to eat. Stretch when they tell you to stretch. If you take care of your body, if his body holds up,
phenomenal.
He has a chance to go down as one of the great players in the history of the NBA. But you can't do it if you're not healthy.
Yeah.
All right, coming up, you're not going to believe what John Gruden has to say. That's next on First Things First. Welcome back. First Things First, Super Bowl champ Chris Canty back with us.
Just a
thanks
little
for coming
break,
back.
Quick break.
It was quick.
When I had a bagel.
Yeah, when I had a bagel.
He took a nap underneath the desk. He's
no,
been
I
here
didn't
all
do that.
Along.
No, not at all.
You carved it up? You carb loaded?
No, no carb loading. Like I said, just
you
a
said
cup
bagel.
Of tea.
I didn't know. I mean,
no, just a cup of tea. Sit back, tea. Relax, enjoy the show.
So civilized.
Yeah. I don't necessarily agree with you guys on the whole mush punch thing with Tristan
really?
Thompson and Draymond.
Wait, what do you think?
Really? No, I just feel like a mush is so much more disrespectful.
I agree.
It is, but do
yes.
you have...
Would you
if,
rather
if,
I, be
if you get mushed, you can laugh. Man, you ain't, you know, but a punch,
no,
you gotta
no, no,
fight,
no.
Right?
Either way, it's going to escalate to an altercation. It's going
I
down.
Knew you were
no,
smart
no,
man.
No doubt about it. If you mush me, that means that you didn't respect me as a man enough to punch me.
What if
I don't understand. Like, I feel like if you punch me, there's
more.
A little more,
yeah.
there's a
but
little
if
more
it's
respect
a sucker
behind
punch,
that.
It might knock you out. And
well,
you
at least,
get a
at least you thought
respond.
Enough of me to realize that you had to punch me rather than to mush me.
This is actually a great discussion.
There is no discussion.
So
there is no debate.
Hold on. I'm not debating you on that.
Okay.
What it is, we kind of got into this one, which is growing up a basketball player, most big guys, and Tristan Thompson was a big guy. They haven't ever been in a fight ever in their life, right? Whereas you get to, like, Draymond Green, I believe Draymond Green has been in fights.
Yes.
Every point guard has been in fights because you either are willing to fight or you're not going to play, right? Whereas you are a power forward, I guarantee, and a football players have all been in fights. Not because football, every play can be a fight.
Every play is a fight.
Right,
it's aggravated
right. Whereas
assault
like,
40
like,
times a game.
Like Shaq and those dudes, like, they ain't ever been in a fight.
Nobody messing with them.
They have no idea how to fight. So I think Tristan Thompson mushed him because he has never been in a fight before. One, Canadian, nice dude, you know.
So, Doug, what you're saying is one guy is scared and the other one is glad of it.
Yeah. Well,
okay. I don't think
Tristan is scared.
Fascinating.
I think Tristan is ticked. I think he's
No, Tristan Thompson is glad that Draymond Green is scared. That's why he pushed him.
Okay. We'll get back to this after the break. Let's get to John Gruden, who signed a 10-year, $100 million deal to leave the broadcast booth for the sidelines this offseason. While the head coach's return has Raider Nation very excited, many critics have ripped Gruden for being behind the times, most notably for showing the team film from 1976. Gruden defended himself, saying we're not running a 1964 operation here. Chris, how hard will it be for Gruden's transition back to the NFL?
I think it's going to be tough. And the more and more I hear coming out of Oakland, the more and more
right.
I believe this is going to be a boom or bust proposition with John Gruden. Like, he's coaching guys that don't know him as a head coach. John Gruden's last year in the NFL as a head coach was 2008. Yeah. Most of the guys on that team were probably in middle school. So I'm just saying, when you start talking about relating to today's athlete, I don't know that John Gruden is doing a great job of that. Like, it's something different to be involved in the pre-draft process and talking to quarterbacks and quarterback confidential. It's another thing to be in the locker room with these guys and be in these meetings and trying to get them to trust you. But more so now than ever, players, before they'll listen to what you have to say, they have to trust that you have their best interests in mind. And the style of football that John Gruden is talking about playing is something that's completely foreign to these guys. I mean, it's, you know, you start talking about playing back in 1998, what football is like. That's not what they're playing in 2018. You know, even 2008 in 2018, it's a completely different style of play in the NFL. So when you start looking at these guys trying to play that style of football and then John Gruden showing them tapes from the 60s and 70s, I just don't know about it.
This reminds me, I have a really good friend who was in the quarterback room with the Redskins when Joe Gibbs came back. Remember, Joe Gibbs took time away and went and started NASCAR. And they're like, they started the offensive install day. The wide receivers were in a three-point stance. And they were like, dude, we got to cut this, pull this tape, right? Because players don't respect that.
Right.
I can't emphasize to people more, you can't fool players. Players are so much smarter than we ever give them credit. We think some aren't. Sometimes in terms of language, you know, they may not be professors in terms of their diction and how they present themselves. But for their sport, they are absolutely brilliant. Otherwise, they wouldn't be there. And you can't fool them. And if you try and all these tricks with let me show you what football was like back in the 70s. And like dudes are going to roll their eyes and you're going to lose them before you ever play a game. And then you factor in. Hell, in the fifth round, they took the kid out of Michigan who's got a heart problem that you shouldn't draft. They took so many chances and so many risks in the draft that you lose respect from other people in the league. I this does run the risk of disaster. And the good news is for the rest of the league, it's a 10-year contract.
Right.
So I guess he'll find a way to work it out and he'll learn by trial and error. But so far, everyone keeps pointing to the fact that John Gruden, I think he felt like he was the cool guy in the room because everybody saw him on Monday Night Football and he could relate to guys. But it's totally different when it's the pre-draft process as opposed to the everyday process of being an NFL coach.
Look, the best thing he did other than winning that Super Bowl was beat Monday Night Football and Coach Gruden with the quarterbacks and all of that, because he came to Oakland like he was Bill Belichick. Mm. All right, he had not mastered football in 2000. His last playoff win was 2002. Mm. Three of his last 6 years in Tampa Bay, losing seasons. Two of those times, only twice did they make the playoffs. So we're not talking about a guy who was just ultra dominant even in his era. And I'll compare it to an NBA situation. Tom Thibodeau. When Thibodeau coached in Chicago, he was the best defensive coach in the league, bar none. He had Nate Robinson, Derrick Rose, guys that weren't great defenders, Carlos Boozer, and he had the best defense in the league. Put him in today's game. Minnesota, for the 3 years he's been there, has been one of the worst defensive teams in the league because his whole strategy was pack it in, force them to shoot the three. You do that in today's game, the way it's changed, you're getting killed. And I know he's tried to adjust, but that's not who he is. And so just like basketball, football is so much different now that I do think it's going to be a hard transition.
Phil Jackson triangle, right?
Right.
Phil Jackson triangle, right? Like, you go, oh, man, it worked for – it's a different sport. It's almost a different sport, not just a different era.
Is this an ego thing? Is this a understanding thing? I mean, can Gruden eventually adjust to what he needs to do to help this team be successful?
I think the dynamic between the head coach and the players has shifted a little bit since Gruden was at last a head coach in the National Football League. It's almost a situation where you have to coddle the players a little bit more in the NFL because they're younger guys. The league has made a conscious effort to turn rosters over. You don't have as many of what I call the middle-class guys or the glue guys in your locker room. It's a lot of guys that are making $3 million or less or $10 million or more. So you don't have a lot of veteran players to kind of help send the message from the head coach to the rest of the young players in the locker room, show them how to be professional. So a lot of that falls on the coaching staff, and the head coach has to be a part of that. Another thing that worries me about John Gruden sending the right message to his team is you haven't talked to Khalil Mack since you took the job as the Oakland Raiders head coach. I mean, you haven't talked to him since that point. You've only talked to him once. He's a defensive player of the year, one of the leaders on that team, arguably the best player on that team, and you've only talked to him once? I don't care if you've made an effort to reach out on with several other attempts. You got to prioritize that and make sure that you speak with him, even though you're having this contract standoff with the front office. That has to happen. That's unacceptable.
By the way, that's the first thing he should have done when he got the job. Not even doing it now. The first thing you should do is sit down with the best players on each side of the football and understand the leadership of that locker room. Have a face-to-face so they know you, know what – who knows better what the team didn't do last year that caused the coaching staff to get fired than Khalil Mack. I'm sure you sat down with Derek Carr, you know, right? Why wouldn't you sit down with Khalil Mack? And then he made the mistake that college coaches make this all the time, where they say, well, wait till we get my guys in, and they disrespect the previous staff's recruits. He said, hey, look, we weren't any good defensively last year with Khalil Mack. Like, hey, some of those guys, even if it's inarguable that the Raiders were bad defensively, hell, they were bad defensively when they made the playoffs 2 years, mm-hmm. 2 years ago. Mm. Even if that's inarguable, you don't say it. You don't say that loud because some of those guys are in your locker room. And they're
sounds so disrespectful.
It doesn't it?
Hey,
you guys sucked, but I'm going to somehow fix it magically. Okay?
All right. Chris, we're gonna keep you around here. Coming up is Des Bryant about to cause trouble for another locker room. That is next on First Things First. Des Bryant, the embattled wide receiver, still without a job. He may be closing in on an opportunity. The Browns and Des have had initial talks, and Cleveland is a betting favorite to land Bryant. But, Chris, would signing Des Bryant be bad for Baker Mayfield?
Yeah, you know what? I just don't like it. With the wide receiver room that the Cleveland Browns already have, I think introducing that element, it's already a young team. I don't know that they have the guys in there, the leaders in the locker room that can absorb a personality like Des Bryant. I'm not saying that Des is a bad player, but I think Des in terms of fit, in terms of who he is as a person, it's got to be with a veteran ball club. It's not the Cleveland Browns. Even though from a skill set perspective, I think he would add something to that team, I just don't like his personality in that locker room. Not for where the Cleveland Browns as an organization is right now.
No, I hear you. I think that's a huge red flag. If I signed Dez and I'm Cleveland, I would want it to be an incentive-laden contract where 1 year incentive-laden, where if you act up, you cause problems, I can get rid of you quickly. Although, maybe he could still do enough damage in whatever brief time he was there to ruin the season. But I think Baker Mayfield, too, seems to have the personality where he would go back at Dez. Mm. You know, but I just wonder if Dez is motivated enough. I don't want to say he's been humbled. I don't think he has been humbled.
If you check his Twitter account, you can see that he hasn't been
humbled. I don't think he's been humbled enough. But there's certainly the motivation for him to have a great season, the best season he can possibly have at this point in his career, and also be a good guy because we know next year he wants a big contract. So that's the saving grace, but I totally hear you on it's a risk because of his personality.
I think it's interesting that the Patriots haven't reached out. I think that might tell you a little all you need to know. Here the Patriots are desperately in need of wide receiving help. He wouldn't cost them a lot of money. They've taken on veteran players in the past. There's no challenging the authority of Tom Brady in terms of who runs that locker room, and they haven't picked up the phone and called. That would send signals to me if I'm Cleveland, where I'm at the opposite end of the spectrum. I got a head coach who's hanging on for his job. I have a quarterback in Tyrod Taylor who just led the Bills to the playoffs and believes he should be the starter the entire season. The pressure to play Baker Mayfield, that throws in a, there's a little Carmelo Anthony to this in that Carmelo can still play, yeah. Dez can still play, but are you willing to take a secondary or tertiary role? He got 133 balls thrown his way last year. That's not going to happen this year. And everyone will sit there in a meeting room and say, no, I'm okay not getting as many balls. But then on Sunday, you're still Dez Bryant. You're still throwing on 88. You're still used to the ball coming your way. Can you accept that, especially when you're playing for a team that didn't win a game last year and won one game the year before? That's really hard for your ego to accept. I would stay away if I was the Browns. And frankly, if I'm Dez, I wait till you have just the right team at just the right time. When a guy goes down, it might not be week one.
Doug, I think you brought up a valid point in terms of role on the field, but I look at more so the role in the locker room and that dynamic because, you know, Dez Bryant is an alpha. He's going to come in. He's going to bring some leadership qualities. Now, whether or not you want that to be the identity of your ball club, I'm not sure. But if you're the Cleveland Browns, there is no urgency in terms of trying to win and get into the postseason. Right now, it's all about development. That's not just with the players and their skill sets on the field, but that's actually allowing the emergence of leaders from your young ball club in the locker room. And so if you bring in Dez Bryant, you're naturally taking away an opportunity for another young guy to lead on that football team.
There's also this one thing, though. The franchise wants to develop their young players, but the head coach wants to win so he can stay employed.
Jimmy Haslam did come out earlier last week and say that this is like Hugh Jackson's first year because Sashi Brown and Paul DePodesta and their Moneyball approach to drafting players didn't work out. So this is almost like a fresh, clean start for Hugh Jackson. He did say clean slate.
But if you weren't hired by the general manager, that's a tough one, right?
That is a tough one. He's not John Dorsey's guy, but I feel like because Hugh Jackson is so good in terms of teaching the game, especially with guys on the offensive side of the ball, and you have a young quarterback in Baker Mayfield, I think they'll give that every opportunity to work out.
So it would be a risk for Cleveland. What about from Dez's perspective? Would that be a potential good fit for him and what he's trying to show? Does he wait and see if later on another team would be interested? From his side of things, what do you think he does?
Well, I don't think there's any downside if you're Dez Bryant. There's no place for the Cleveland Browns to go but up. They were 0-16 last year. They've 1-31 over the last two. So if you're Dez Bryant and you step on that team and you're productive and they actually have some production in the way of wins, I think that reflects well on you. So it means that can create more of a market for you next year. And, Chris, you said it. Dez Bryant is going to be motivated because it's going to be a one-year proposition, whatever contract that he signs with whatever team. He already turned down a 3-year deal with the Baltimore Ravens earlier this offseason. He's looking to cash in on the open marketplace. It's not going to happen this year, so he's going to be on his best behavior in hopes that it happens next offseason.
What do you think for the Browns? What do you think their ceiling is this season and what they could potentially do, given the fact they only had one win in the last two seasons?
Well, I, I like the defense. They've got some pieces over there. They're not as far off on that side of the ball as their record might say they were last year. But I'm looking at the Cleveland Browns and saying they're a 4 or 5 win ball club, and that's a big improvement for that team.
4 or 5 wins, wow.
Well, they won one game last 2 years.
I know. Look, I'm from Cleveland, man. I was hoping you said 7 or 8.
Well, look, I mean,
at the ceiling.
Remember, Cincinnati kind of bottomed out here last year. They should be better. Pittsburgh Steelers, I don't think they'll be as good without Chase here, but they're still Pittsburgh Steelers with Antonio Brown and Le'Veon Bell, and they like a lot of dudes.
Baltimore got a really good defense.
And Baltimore should have been in the playoffs last year. So I think you have to consider they're not. If they're in the AFC East, it might be a little bit different because you run up on the Jets or the Bills or the Miami Dolphins.
But you heard what Jarvis Landry said. He got a brother optimistic.
That sounds good in August when they're not playing real games. We'll see what happens when it kicks off in September.
Chris, thank you for being here with us. We've certainly enjoyed it. Maybe even the commercial breaks more so than the show.
I'm telling you.
The show within
coming
the show.
Up, Kevin Durant can't lay off social media. The latest from Katie's timeline next on First Things First.
Thank you for listening to the First Things First podcast. Remember, leave us a review and tell us what you think. Subscribe to the podcast on Apple Podcasts and catch us on FS1 Monday through Friday, 6:30 a.m. Eastern. For Chris Carter and Nick Wright, I'm Jenna Wolf. So long, everybody.